Well, good morning. Happy Father's Day. They say that you look at the Sundays of the church year, and typically one of the most well-attended Sundays of the year is Mother's Day weekend. You've got Easter, you've got Christmas, then you got Mother's Day and the big Sundays. And then on the opposite end of the spectrum, you have Father's Day, which is typically the lowest attendance on a particular Sunday. So we've got a few empty seats here today. We had a good crowd in the early service, a few empty seats here, but it does say God's promise in the scriptures is where two or three are gathered in his name, that he is present there among them. And so we've got a few more than two or three gathered here today, and we know that God is truly present here today, and we pray that he'll continue to fill these pews, even today and week after week. But hey, it is good to be here. You could have chosen to be anywhere today. Certainly, we want to honor Father, so there's some barbecues probably going on and parties and such like that. But we recognize that the most important father of them all is God, our Heavenly Father. And we praise him from whom all blessings flow. And he is indeed most worthy of our praise. And as we recognize that, let us stand together as we sing our opening song.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
The sun comes up,
someday dawning, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
Bless
the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. On that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
Bless
the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name.
And in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us, but if we confess our sins, God is faithful. He is just. His promise is that he'll forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In light of that truth, in light of God's promises from his word, as we come before him, knowing that he is holy, that we are sinners in need of his forgiveness, let us confess our sins unto him. Lord, we humbly come before you and ask for your forgiveness.
We have failed to love you as you have loved us. We do not fully love our neighbor as ourselves. Our words are sometimes harsh and bitter.
We think more about our welfare
than the needs of others. We do not deserve your love or forgiveness, but we appeal to your mercy. Forgive us and renew us. Grow all the fruit of the Spirit in us, through us, especially the fruit of love. Help us to love others well as you first loved us.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and it is for his sake that he forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word, I announce the grace of God unto you, the forgiveness of all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated, and kids, come forward. We got a children's message this morning. All of our kids, if you'll come forward. Oh, I guess I did skip the reading, didn't I? But kids, come forward. We'll call an audible here. We'll do the reading after the message. All right, well, good morning. Come have a seat, if you will. Come sit down with me. Yeah, all right. I have in my hand here today, do you know what this is? This is an ice cube tray. No, I didn't take this from home. I've been taking all kinds of stuff from home for the children's message each week, and they're having a fun game at home trying to figure out what I'm going to take this week. But the ice cube trays, right? This is what do you make in these? So tell me, how do you do it? So you put water in it, and you put it in the refrigerator, you said. Do you put it in the refrigerator, or do you think you put it somewhere else?
Refrigerator.
In the refrigerator? How about the freezer? Yeah, I think the freezer would probably be better, because if you put it in the refrigerator, it's not going to freeze the ice. So you put it in the freezer, and then what do? You take it out?
No.
No.
Wait for a few minutes.
You wait, probably for more than a few minutes. You probably have to wait a few hours maybe tomorrow. You put it in today, and then you wait until tomorrow, and what do you have then? You'll have ice, exactly. But the important thing, the most important step after you pour the water in and put it in the freezer, the most important step is to wait. And that's what we're going to be talking about in today's sermon. We're going to talk about waiting. We're going to be talking about having patience. Because with God, one of the most common phrases that we hear in the scriptures, one of the most common commands is to wait on the Lord. And when we pray to God, sometimes God says yes. What else does God say sometimes? He says yes. What's the opposite of that? Sometimes he says no. And then other times he doesn't say yes. He doesn't say no. He just says not yet. Right? So sometimes the best things that God wants to give to us and do for us in our lives, we simply have to wait. And it's hard sometimes to have patience, because if I want something, I want it when? I want it now. Not tomorrow, not next year, but I want it now. But God says sometimes we need to wait, because we need to learn, we need to grow. And he's our Heavenly Father. And he always knows what's good for us. He knows what's bad for us. And he also knows the best time for us as well. So hey, let's fold our hands and bow our heads. And if everyone will repeat after me. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness. Help us to wait on you, to hear your answer in prayer, whether it be yes or no, or maybe later. give us patience. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up today.
Our epistle reading today comes from Galatians chapter 5, starting on the 16th verse. My counsel is this: live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. Then you won't feed the compulsion of selfishness. For there is a root of sinful self-interest in us that is at odds with a free spirit, just as the free spirit is incompatible and selfishness. These two ways of life are contrary to each other, so that you cannot live at times one way and at times another way, according to how you would feel on any given day. Why don't you choose to be led by the Spirit and so escape the erratic compulsions of a law-dominated existence? It is obvious what kind of life develops out of trying to get your own way all the time. Repetitive, loveless, cheap sex, a stinking accumulation of mental and emotional garbage, frenzied and joyless happiness, trinkets, gods, magic show religion, paranoid loneliness, cutthroat competition, all-consuming, ever yet never satisfied wants, a brutal temper, an impotence to love or to be loved, divided homes and divided lives, small-minded and lopsided pursuits, the vicious habit of depersonalizing everyone into a rival, uncontrolled and uncontrollable addictions, ugly parodies of community. I could go on. This isn't the first time I have warned you, you know. If you use your freedom this way, you will not inherit God's kingdom. But what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others, exuberance about life, serenity. We develop a willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, not heeding to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. Legalism is helpless in bringing this about. It only gets in the way. Among those who belong to Christ, everything connected with getting our own way and mindlessly responding to what everyone else calls necessities is killed off for good, crucified. Since this is the kind of life we have chosen, the life of the Spirit, let us make sure that we do not just hold it as an idea in our heads or a sentiment in our hearts, but work out its implications in every detail of our lives. That means we will not compare ourselves with each other as if one of us were better and another worse. We have far more interesting things to do with our lives. Each of us is an original. This is the word of God. I ask you to rise now for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading comes from the book of Luke, starting in the eighth chapter, starting with the fourth verse. And when a great crowd was gathering, and people from town after town came to him, he said in a parable, a sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded a hundredfold. As he said these things, he called out, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when his disciples asked him what this parable meant, he said, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God, but for others they are in parable, so that seeing they may not see and hearing they may not understand. Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard, then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rocks are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil, they are those who hear the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart, and bear fruit with patience. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Let us confess our faith now with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated.
Carried a burden too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, laying it down. I know that I need you. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. So my condition had a plan from the start. Your Son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. I'll run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 and again. Oh, oh, oh.
Our verse of the month, this month of June, is Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, where it lists for us the nine fruit of the Spirit. I invite you to join me in reciting these words. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. I don't know if you have caught this or not, but the last few weeks we have been in this message series focused on the fruit of the Spirit, and every single week during this message series, our epistle lesson, the first reading, has been this section of Galatians. But every week there's been something different about it, in that I picked a different translation to be read each week. This week was the most unique translation of them all. It was from the Message translation, which was translated by Eugene Peterson. He had a little bit different take. We didn't see these things listed: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Rather, it was a different take, as I said. And I want to give you a quick lesson in Bible translation. Understand that the original Bible was written, the Old Testament for the most part was written in Hebrew, and the New Testament was written in Greek. And so we have translations, our English Bibles, our translations of the original languages. And we have several, many different translations. The most common one that we use here at Emmanuel is the ESV translation, the English Standard Version. Popular a number of years ago was the NIV translation. And you go back 100 years or so, and the most popular translation at that point in time was the King James Version of the Bible. Well, as I said, the reading today came from the Message translation. And the thing that makes the Message translation unique is that most other Bible translations, in fact, I would say probably all Bible translations in English, are translated by a committee, translated by a group of people that come together, get together, and they discuss and they debate about how the Bible should be translated. Whereas the Message translation that was written today, that we had read today, was translated by one person by the name of Eugene Peterson. And I encourage you to have a good study Bible and a translation like the English Standard Version and use that translation to study the Bible. But it's also good that you have the Bible that you study to also compare it to other translations that you might be able to find online that maybe give you a different perspective or a different take on that same scripture. And as I said, the Message translation is the most unique of them all. I wouldn't encourage you to use the Message translation to study the Bible. It's more of a devotional take on the Bible to look at, to compare it to your English Standard Version and how Eugene Peterson understands this scripture compared to how the ESV translates it. But I want to look at this verse where he describes the fruit of the Spirit. Verses 22 and 23, he says, God brings gifts into our lives much in the same way that fruit appears in the orchard. Things like affection for others, translated love. Exuberance about life, translated joy. Serenity, translated peace. We develop a willingness to stick with things, which we're talking about today, patience. A sense of compassion in the heart, kindness. A conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people, that would be goodness. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, faithfulness, not needing to force our way of life, that would be gentleness, and able to marshal and direct our energies wisely, that would be self-control. So there you have the fruit of the Spirit. We have the things like love, and joy, and peace, and patience, and kindness, and goodness, and faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Hannah, for some reason my sermon did not get brought over to this service. Can you look up the early service and put my sermon outline in? Thank you. And by the way, it should have been handed in as you came in, an outline for today's message. You can take notes. I have all the different scripture readings that will be used in there. You can follow along and take notes. So the fourth fruit of the Spirit that we're going to be looking at today is patience. We talked about love, joy, peace, and today is patience. God is patient. All of the fruit of the Spirit, there's no one that exhibits the characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit more than God. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, you know, they were expecting the Savior, the Christ, the Messiah, to come just around the corner. But what happened? Galatians chapter 4, God sent the Son, Jesus, into the world at just the right time. They were expecting it a lot sooner. They hoped it would be a lot sooner. But 4,000 years in the making, God knew best. The Father knows best. He sent the Son, the Savior, into the world to die on the cross, to rise from the dead at just precisely the right moment in history. It was not in our time or in our timing. It was in God's timing. Furthermore, Jesus ascended into heaven, and he gave the promise. He says, I'm going to be with you always to the very end of the age. Right? I'm going to be with you always to the end of the age. And he promised that he would return in glory to judge the living and the dead, that there would be the great resurrection, and all would be joined together, those of who are of faith, in his heavenly paradise. But we're 2,000 years in the making. 2,000 years into the waiting. When will Jesus return? Maybe today, maybe tomorrow. It might not be for another 100 years, 1,000 years, or 2,000 years from now. I don't know when. You don't know when. Jesus says no one knows the day nor the hour. Only the Father knows. So we don't know. But we're waiting. We're waiting. Patiently waiting for him to return. To usher in and bring in that time where there'll be no more pain, no more sorrow, for the old order of things will be passed away. But look at this verse that we have on the screen. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Again, it's in the outline too that was handed out. It says, do not overlook this one fact. This is an important truth here. Take notice, Peter says, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like, what's it say? 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord, he is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness. We might think that God is slow to deliver, slow on his promises. But recognize that God's timing is not our timing. We live in finite time. There's a minute, there is an hour, there is a day, there is a year. We live in a place where time is finite. But with God, God lives in eternity. And he has a totally different way of looking at things than how we look at things. So the Lord, he is not slow, as some count slowness. But he is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. Again, God knows what he is doing. And as we talk about patience today, we need to understand that God directs us and calls us to have patience, first of all, towards him. Patience towards God. To recognize that this is an important step of faith. That we think we know the answer. We think that we know what we want. We think that we know what we need. But God calls us to trust him. that he knows what he is doing. And even when we think he is slow to deliver, slow to come along, that we're about ready to give up on his promises, God, indeed, he knows what he is doing. And he calls us not to give up on him. There is verse Psalm 46, verse 10. It says, "Be still and know that I am God." Be still. Many of you know that Christine and I were on a cruise this past week. It was great to get away for a week, to have all your meals cooked for you, to have someone make your bed for you. We had a great time away. Every day on the ship, we were given an itinerary, different activities that took place during the day. And one of the activities on Friday night was Shabbat, the Sabbath. In Jesus' day, and for Jewish people to this day, do you know when the day begins? It begins at sundown. So the Sabbath begins where we would think the Sabbath is on Saturday. So it would begin at the beginning of the day, at sunrise. But in the Hebrew day calendar, the day begins at sundown. That was why it was so very important when Jesus died upon the cross on Good Friday that they took his body down off the cross and they buried him before the beginning of the Shabbat, before the beginning of the Sabbath, which started at Friday at sundown. But you think about this, the whole point of this, why I'm telling you this, is there's a different mindset when your day begins, what we consider the end of the day, versus your day beginning at the beginning of the day. Because we wake up in the morning, we get ready, and then we go to work and go do all of those things that we do. We keep ourselves busy only to collapse at night and fall asleep and rest. And we're busy, busy, busy because of all the things that we've got to do and all the things that are on our mind. But there's a different mindset when your day begins at sunset, because what's the first thing that you do? You go to sleep. You go to bed. And you say to yourself, well, I've got a lot of stuff to do. But before I do all of that, what's it say in there? Psalm 46, verse 10? Be still and know that I am God. Because maybe I'm worried, maybe I'm anxious about all of those things that I have to do. But before I get worried and anxious about all those things that I have to do, I'm going to stop, I'm going to pause, and I'm going to be still and know that God is in his place and that he's got this all taken care of. Jesus calls us, he says, seek first all of those things that you have to do. No, what does he call you to seek first? He calls you to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all of those other things that you're worried and anxious about, he will take care of those things. Furthermore, on patience, it says here in the book of 1 Timothy, Paul writes, have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself to be godly. Train yourself to be godly. I want to focus on the second part of that verse where he talks about training yourself to be godly. Say you want to go out and run a marathon. How long's a marathon? A marathon is 26 miles. So if you're going to train yourself to run a marathon, would you go out and run 26 miles tomorrow? Some of you are saying, I'm not going to run 26 miles ever in my life. That's okay. But if you were to train to run a marathon, would you go out and start running 26 miles right away? No. You wouldn't be able to. What would you focus on first? Probably running 1 mile. Let me do 1 mile first. And then once I achieve being able to run fully, completely 1 mile, then I'm going to go for 2 miles. And you build yourself up over time. Training yourself in godliness, training yourself in righteousness, seeking first the kingdom of God. It's doing today what you can do today so that you can do more tomorrow. And you do tomorrow what you do tomorrow so that the day after that you can do a little bit more. You see, spiritual growth takes time. Spiritual growth takes patience. Think about opening the scriptures. You don't become a Bible scholar overnight, a trained theologian to be able to teach at a seminary. But you open up the scriptures and you start understanding it and learning it one verse at a time. And as you discover and you seek and you understand more and more one verse, then you go on to the next verse and the next verse. So many of us, we overestimate what we can accomplish in a given day. But we step back and we look at what we can do today and just a little bit each and every day. If you focus on increasing and improving 1% today, which isn't very much, over the course of a year, that's 365%. I was recently reading a book. It was called Slow Productivity. When it comes to the American sense of productivity, we don't think of being slow. Productivity, being productive is being fast, being effective, doing more and more, overloading our schedule. But the point of the author in this book was, first of all, do fewer things. Because when you're doing a whole bunch of things, what happens is you're bouncing from one thing to the next thing to the next thing, and you're so distracted. You have all these things that you're doing, but at the end of the day, you say, did I really even get anything done? And we have so many unfinished tasks in our lives because we're all trying to do so much. So he says, focus on fewer things. In fact, if you can, focus on just one thing at a time. Furthermore, work at a natural pace. Because if you're running hectic, you're going to wear yourself out. You're going to burn yourself out. And finally, focus on quality. We want to do things with excellence. We're not serving man. We're not even serving ourselves. We are serving the Lord of the universe. And in worship and in praise to him, we want to do everything we can to the best of our ability. And if we're working fast, that's not going to happen. Second, God invites us to practice patience towards others. God invites us to practice patience towards others. We need to have patience with others. If you don't believe me, go drive on Interstate 75. Or drive on Interstate 4. There you will quickly learn how much you need to develop patience. I have this happen where I'll be at a stoplight, and the light turns green, and the person in front of me just sits there. They finally recognize that the light's green, and they hit the gas, and they slowly begin to go forward, just ever so slowly getting through the light. And then just as my car gets to the front, the light turns red. I was like, one car got through that light. We could have got five cars at least through that light. Or then you're at the grocery store, and you get in line, there's one person in front of you in the line. And then the line over here has three people in line, right? So you're standing in line, and the person in front of you, they have a price check. And then there's another problem that comes up. In the meantime, all three people that were in the other line, they've gone through their line, and plus two other people showed up and went through the line as well. And you're still waiting there. Can anyone relate to those experiences? God calls us to have patience towards others. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Here's a suggestion for you. The next time you're stuck in traffic, rather than picking what you think is the fast lane, Get in the slow lane. Turn off your radio and spend some time with God. Start praying. Praying for the people that are passing you by and are in such a hurry that God would speak to their hearts and maybe give them patience and help them to know his love. Or maybe what you can do, turn on the music. Turn on some worship music and use that time to worship God. Next time you're in line or getting in line at the grocery store, pick the longest line. And then pray. Pray for the people who are in line in front of you. Pray for the person who is the cashier or working in customer service, because that's sometimes a very hard job, a thankless job. And here's the thing that I found, that God has a way of opening doors and opportunities. And sometimes when I pick what I think is going to be the slow lane, and I start to seek first the kingdom of God in that, that slow lane becomes the fast lane. And you get in that line, and again, you're seeking first the kingdom of God, and you're praying for the people who are in line together with you. Or maybe you strike up a conversation and are able to share your faith with a person in line. But I find that I pick that slow lane. I seek first the kingdom of God, and the slowest line ends up becoming the fastest line. We have an amazing God who is a God of miracles in so many ways. Another verse here, Ephesians 4, verse 2, with all humility and gentleness, with patience. This is some strong language here. What are we to do with one another? Bear with one another in love. Endure, in other words, one another in love. Because if you live in relationship with another person, whether it is a spouse, whether it is a child, whether it's a father on his Father's Day weekend, whether it is a mother, a coworker, that other person at some point in time, they are going to let you down. They are going to disappoint you. And the thing is that God is loving and forgiving towards us. It says he does not treat us as our sins deserve. Here, the Lord, he is a merciful God, a gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love that we don't deserve, love and faithfulness. God is forgiving towards us. And it's hard. It's hard. I recognize that sometimes you forgive someone for something that they said, something that they did, and you think that's the end of it, but then they end up doing it again. And you forgive them once again. The relationship is restored, all is well. And then what happens? They do it again. But what does God call us to? Bear with one another in love. Practice patience if you have to. Peter asks, 7 times? No, Jesus says, 70 times 7. Be loyal. Be faithful, be forgiving, be patient. Love. Ultimately, when we look at the fruit of the Spirit, all the things that come after love, joy, peace, patience, it all flows out of love. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, love is patient. If you truly love God, if you truly love others, you're going to practice patience towards them. So God invites us to practice patience towards him, towards others, and last but not least, God calls us to practice patience with ourselves, with yourself. Here's the NIV translation, Philippians 2, verses 12 through 13. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, what does it say? Continue. Continue to work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. Now, I'm going to step back for a moment from that statement, continue to work out your salvation. Know that your salvation is one. Jesus died on the cross once and for all. Your sins are forgiven if you believe in him. Because he lives, we too may live a new life. You don't need to go back and to win your salvation and do what Jesus did. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your work, so that not one of us can boast. But here it says, continue to work out your salvation. So what does Paul mean in this verse? Well, what he means is here is to grow in understanding, to grow in what it means that Jesus died for me and saved me from my sins. Thomas was asking earlier in the service, he says, why are the colors green on the altar during this season of Pentecost? And a big part of that is that the color green, when you think of green, what do you think of? You think of trees, you think of the grass in your yard, you think of the flowers in the field. Green is a color that represents growth. And we are continually a work in progress. You know that? You are a work in progress as long as you are walking on this earth. It is not until we are in glory with God that we are fully matured. So no matter how young or how old you are, recognize that you are a work in progress, and therefore practice patience with yourself. Because what happens is you take a step forward, you take another step forward, and then what happens? You take a step back. And maybe you take two more steps back before you take five steps forward. And life is like that. There's a step forward. For every step forward, there's a step back. For every two step forward, there's another step back. It's not all a straight line of progression. So practice patience with yourself, because you make mistakes. You do dumb things. You are forgetful. We came back from our vacation yesterday, and we stopped at my parents' house to pick up the boys. And my suitcase had broke, so I had borrowed a suitcase from my mom. And I had a backpack, I had a suitcase, and I'm transferring everything back into my broken suitcase that I can take all of my stuff home. Took everything out to the car, and about halfway home, I get a phone call. My mom says, one of the boys left their backpack at our house. And I started to get upset at Jacob. I said, he forgot his backpack. Oh, that boy. Jacob's like, I didn't forget my backpack. I didn't have a backpack. And so we called my mom back and said, what's in the backpack? And she started describing the things that were in the backpack. You guess whose backpack it was? It was my backpack. So sometimes your impatience with others, you know, what does Jesus say? Don't point at the speck in someone else's eye and not see the log that is in your own eye. But I was pretty upset with myself. But we do those things, don't we? We forget things. We make dumb decisions. But as much as you need to forgive others, you also need to forgive yourself. Because God has forgiven you. God loves you. On this Father's Day weekend, those of you who are fathers, you love your children. Not because they always make the best decision. Not because they always remember to do everything that you tell them and that they need to do. Not because they're always thoughtful. You love them because of who they are. You love them because they are your children. And that's the same way that God loves us. Not because of who we are, because of who we are, not because of what we do, the dumb decisions that we make. He loves us because of who he made us to be through the cross, through baptism. So the point here is to be patient with yourself. As you practice forgiveness towards others, practice forgiveness towards yourself. I'll leave you with this verse. Philippians 3, verse 12. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, But I press on. I continue on to make it my own because Jesus Christ has made me his own. Amen. We continue our worship now as we bring our tithes and our offerings unto the Lord. We pray now for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Let us stand as we pray. We thank you, Lord, for our fathers on this Father's Day weekend. Most importantly, we thank you, our loving Heavenly Father. We pray that you would help fathers everywhere to be the fathers that you have called them to be. Give them wisdom and discernment to instill in their children values and truths that are godly and good. Where there is a broken relationship or a father wound, we pray that you would heal and restore. For those that grieve the loss of a father, we pray that you would comfort them in your grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray in behalf of all those who have been affected by disasters, from hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes. We pray that you would provide for them through time of recovery. Help them to grieve their loss and use your church to minister the gospel in the midst of hopelessness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we live in confusing times and frustrating times. There is anger, there is rage, there is division and fear. We pray, Lord, for patience, for understanding, for wisdom, for faith. Help us, Lord, your church, to be peacemakers and point our culture to Jesus in the confidence and courage that comes from him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the migrant, for the refugee, for all those who do not have a place to call home, whether it is on the border in Mexico, escaping gang warfare in Haiti, or at a camp in Africa. Lord, we pray for provision. We pray that you would move your people to compassion. And we pray, Lord, against the politicizing of the plight of others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray today for passion for your church, for the gospel. Sometimes we feel beat down, broken down, worn out, and exhausted. We grow weary of striving. Forgive us for trusting in ourselves more than you and trying to do life without you. Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Make grace fall down like rain. And Lord, that we would be full of life, giving our all for you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And into your hands, Lord, we commend all of this for which we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who's taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, it was on the night in which he was betrayed that he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after the supper, our Lord took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, drink, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The table of the Lord is prepared, and we share with one another the peace of the Lord.
Pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free. I've been set free. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Take our failure, you take our weakness, you set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, the broken to
now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. I want to invite you to stand now as we receive the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Do not faint, you are.
We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
One last time, happy Father's Day to all of our fathers. Please know that there is a backdrop in the narthex for you to get your picture taken together with your family. So please take advantage of that. I know a lot of people put a lot of hard work into that. We also have a special gift for all fathers. So any dads that are here, make sure to pick up your gift before you leave. As a reminder of the reason why we exist as a church, let us speak our vision statement together. Through word and sacrament ministry, we share the love, joy, and peace of Jesus Christ among ourselves and with those around us. Our worship has ended. Our service now begins. Let us go in peace
and serve the Lord.